Welcome to Carnelian Wealth Creator Series. Thank you very much for taking time out this afternoon and joining us. As you all know that under this series, we discuss various companies from our portfolio which we believe are going through transformation or transformative journey and offer significant wealth creation opportunities. The fact that we have in our portfolio, we do believe in them, but more importantly, we want to give insights to our investors and participants that how we think about looking at opportunities and also kind of get you insight right from the horse's mouth who are leading these opportunities. We call these transformative journeys companies in our portfolio as magic portfolio companies. So here, we usually look for companies where who are into structurally large, very big opportunities and who have created some edge, some moat, and are run by great management teams. But at the same time, we also love when there is a perception gap. The market is seeing them differently, and we are able to find a little different perspective on them and be a little ahead of them. I mean, that's our, because that's when you get a lot of value, right? And we are going to talk about one such great story today, which we kind of have been invested for quite some time, which we believe that has been going through a transformative journey. And also, we had, of course, written a detailed report on that or a note on that last month. So as you all know that we're going to talk about Praj Industries, and we have Shishir with us to discuss about on that. So, this is a very interesting story. We've been tracking for some time, and it's been going through transformative journey on two fronts. Usually we look for one, but we have found this company is going through two transformative processes. One, at the industry level, at the company which was kind of getting ready for more than a decade, and the structural change happened at the industry level. And secondly, within the company, there was a managerial transformation which was done over the last many years, and which is about, kind of has created a stage for takeoff. And we will discuss more about in detail with Shishir on that. Of course, thank you very much, Shishir. We welcome you on this, and thank you for joining. Shishir is somebody who I've known for more than 15 years. It'll be hard for me to do a formal introduction, but I will still do that. Shishir is more a friend. But let me do a formal introduction. Shishir is by qualification a mechanical engineer from BITS Pilani and an advanced management graduate from Harvard Business School. He has over 35 years of rich experience in various field of engineering. He of course possesses a strong business mind and leadership capability. I have seen that in function over many years across various organizations. He began his career with Thermax and held several key positions and rose through the rank and became EVP and Global Head of Cooling and Heating Business. He was also the director of overseas subsidiaries of Thermax in USA, Europe, and various other continents. Before joining Praj, he served as managing director of SKF India from 2009 to 18, and we also, under his leadership, SKF consolidated his positions as leading manufacturer of bearings, seals, lubrication systems, and other services. Shishir is passionate about smart manufacturing, and he regularly speaks on the topic at various forums. He also co-chairs the CII Innovation Council for Western Region and is member of CII National Committee on Capital Goods, Smart Manufacturing, Trades and Fairs. He's also founding director for Alliance for Energy Efficient Economy, an industry think tank and policy advocacy organization for energy efficiency in India. Of course, when Shishir joined Praj, most people were surprised and many were shocked to see how he left a cushy and comfortable job at an MNC and joined a tiny company called Praj, who did not have a great sort of reputation in the minds of investors. And I'm sure most of them found him that time. I'm sure people questioned his wisdom why he joined. But I also remember meeting him that time and informally, and he told me that it's a gold mine. And I precisely remember the words he used, and there's a lot of potent potential left hidden in the company, and it just needs to be unleashed. And I'm glad that Shishir in last 3 years has kind of lived up to a very small part of that. and I am assuming much more is to come, and much more is to come. But we will definitely, you know, get a lot more insights from Shishir on that. So Shishir, you know, let me, you know, sort of come to you that for a long period of time, Praj was seen as a very sort of not so energetic company, not company who did not sort of live up to the promise or potential it had, partly maybe because of market, partly maybe because of internal reasons. And both things have changed specifically in the last 2 years. You know, not only, you know, I mean, industry has seen a significant change because of lots of government initiatives and in general direction towards sustainability and a lot of interest. So we will split our conversation into these two kind of broad buckets. And so I will sort of leave it to you and to start and say if you can give some sort of, you know, bigger picture in terms of, you know, like you said, it's a gold mine 3 years ago. So what will you say now in terms of, you know, the opportunity space? And I'm sure you've talked a lot about it, but would love to get from our investors how you see it, your big picture thoughts.
Well, thank you, Vikas. Thank you for that long and elaborate introduction. So, and raising the bar. So every time I meet you, you raise the polls. anyway, so very, very happy to be here. I think, as you rightly said, what's happening in the eco space of the business that we operate in, there are very, very positive movements on the enabling the ecosystem in terms of the EBP 20 program in India, the advancing it to 2025, understanding that there's a huge gap between what we can produce today to what we need to produce on one hand. So, and all the enabling sort of moves around that in terms of the interest subvention scheme and you know, blending programs and you know, 5-year buying visibility, etc. So several moves on that front, freeing up of the feedstock. So on the other hand, I think the industry structure has undergone a fundamental change. If we just cut back 2 years, we had single industry, which is sugar, which were the natural owners of an ethanol plant because of the feedstock availability. Then they were limited to 3 states of UP, Maharashtra, and Karnataka, largely speaking. And from there, we have now moved to a situation, and they also had one single feedstock, molasses C, that is after you extract all the sugar, what's left. They, within themselves, government freed up policy to say, all right, you know, you can use sugarcane and directly produce ethanol. There is no need to, you know, produce sugar and then produce ethanol. So that was one fundamental change for the sugar mills themselves, or the owners of ethanol plants. But a more fundamental change came when government freed up, extended the whole feedstock basket by adding the starchy feedstocks to it, which is in form of the broken, you know, food grains, the food grains not fit for human consumption, the excessive food grains, etc., for which we were overflowing. And I think that actually indicates a very fundamental mind shift, and I think very positive mind shift, that God has not gifted us crude oil and gas. What God has gifted us is a country that can produce, which is more than self-sufficient on its agriculture produce, which can produce much more than what it needs. And then there is a technology that comes to play, which sort of transforms this opportunity for, because anything when you produce in excess, then obviously it starts to press the margins and the pricing for the producer. But if you can find alternate use of that production, it will definitely gain much more traction. And that's what happened, because very clearly we need to change the income levels of farmers in our country, which is still a very significantly large population in our country engaged in that particular trade. So from defining a policy that includes farmers to manage greenhouse gas emissions in a very constructive way for safeguarding future, to saving foreign exchange, to improving the energy security, I think the whole gambit has been around a very positive overall ecosystem development for the country. That is what we are witnessing over the last couple of years. This is then further got enhanced because it then did not get limited to what I would call as just the ethanol or the liquid fuel, but also then went on to gas fuel with the Satat program. So many other things also start to roll out as we move forward. And there will be many more variations to come in front of sustainable aviation fuel, marine fuel, and so on, including going all the way up to hydrogen. So there's a clear pathway laid out. I think that's the big thing. There's a big, clear, large runway that is with great visibility that has been sort of put out there. So now it is for the industry players and the stakeholders to then start playing and run on that runway and take their flights off at different moments of time, as the case may be. On the other hand, I think the second thing that is happening is internationally as well, we are seeing that there is a growing recognition that we have to solve the greenhouse gas problem. We cannot continue to ignore this. We will have to solve this problem. And one, there are several measures, carbon sequestration, forestation, afforestation, CCUS, there are many factors. Biofuels is a very definitive way. And the definitive way is that you enhance the share of biofuels into your economy. If a government can take measures around that, that helps to address that concern as well. So we are seeing that many agrarian economies are also realizing, hey, I have this God-given gift to me. I don't have crude oil, but I have this. And there's a technology available that can help me achieve some of the other targets that I have. In any country in the world, you want farmers to get better. There's no question. Yeah, you don't want to let out your precious foreign exchange if you're importing energy and so on. So this is a positive dimension for everybody. From that perspective, I think even internationally, we see a very positive environment building. There was a bit of a setback when US stepped out of the Paris Agreement, but now that they stepped in, we expect that to further gain momentum in the direction. So that's the other one. But then Praj is not the story of only bioenergy. We are a story around several pearls, as I call them. So one of them is ethanol, which is very, very, very central to what we do. That is the core of what we do. That's what we've been known for. That is our largest business. And then there are other businesses that are growing. We have the, and another important factor is in whichever market we have gone, we have created a significant market share for ourselves. Brazil is somewhere we've not played yet, and America is, we're just starting out. If you leave these two aside, in every other market in the world where we are, we have a significant market share, and I'm talking in most of the markets, a market share in excess of 50%. So that shows the prowess of our technological strength, that we are accepted against international competition, and we can stand our ground and we can win. We are not selling because we are cheap. We are selling because we are good. And I think that's very important dimension that I wanted to bring here.
I think, Shishir, I would just want to kind of take you from here only. And I think historically, while, Praj was always seen as a capex company, but I think you and the entire organization and Mr. Chaudhary invested before you significant amount in building that scientific capability or, the technology prowess. So I think slowly it's being perceived more like a technology company than really only a capex oriented company or project oriented company, right? So, could you just give some sense into your scientific capability, what kind of spectrum it spreads on, how do you go about spotting these trends and what are the future things you are working on?
Yeah, sure. So, you very correctly said, if somebody asks me, so, and I can draw parallels to my previous two organizations. So there, when I wanted to impress a new customer saying, come and look at me of who I am. We will typically invite them to see our manufacturing setup, saying, come and see my factory. No one has got systems like this. There are processes and the manufacturing setup, apart from other things as well, of course. But that's not what I do in Praj. In Praj, when I invite a visitor, I tell him, please come to my R&D center. I don't invite them to my factory. I tell them, come and see here. This is where we are building the future. This is where we are investigating. We are trying to find new solutions, because Praj has always believed that our progress comes when we solve a customer problem.
True technology.
The customer problem can come when, and that's one. Number two, we have always focused very, what I would call as pan-geographic, almost across the world, 75 countries. In fact, I think that is now world. We're probably at more around 82 or 83 countries now, where we have established our footprint. There are customers who have been touched by us in these markets. Okay, over 750 references. So when you have that kind of a spread of customer base, then you can't say, yeah, you know what, I got this box of steel that you please buy and we will tell you how this will perform. We have to then say, what is the feedstock you have? what's the behavioral characteristic of that feedstock, what's the biological reaction of that feedstock, what microbes work on that. And it's very simple, right? And I take an example from one of my great colleagues a company with whom we work with, and he told me this very simply. He said, Shishir, it's very simple to say, isn't it? He said, the food that I will like as an American and eat, you will not even touch. You are a human being, I'm also a human being, but you won't touch beef and I won't live without beef and so on. And he said, on the other hand, you guys will eat some vegetable, in his own words, and then I will not eat that. So he said, very spicy stuff. So he said, we are all human beings, but we are different. And similarly, feedstocks, all biological processes recognize that, that feedstocks are different across the world. And they're different feedstocks, they behave differently. We need to find the best process. And that is what our technology effort has been focused on. How can I find the best use of this biomass to be converted into a usable form, so that it then enhances the other goals that you want to meet with? Somewhere you may want to do it because it's a waste of the process, somewhere because you want to solve a pollution problem, somewhere because you want to change. For example, when about almost 10 years ago, when we were in Colombia and the world sugar market was going through an upheaval, so Colombia, by the way, depends a large deal at that time, a large deal on sugar exports. The country's main export was sugar. And when the sugar prices tanked, the country did not know what to do. And then we were invited to a dialogue, and then we suggested to them a plant that we said, well, it is possible for you to set up a plant that can interchangeably produce ethanol or sugar. And that became transformative. We have built every single plant in Colombia since then. No one else has ever built. So I think the whole idea of technology, and I always believed, and that is what Praj has believed for over 35 years, that we need to create a technology solution that solves a customer problem. And therefore, we need to get focused. So coming to more technology side then, so we are very strongly focused on developing microbiology because that is essential to what we do. There's a strong focus on thermal engineering and processes. And of course, then the what I would call as all the processes on the because biology by itself is not enough. We also need to then understand the chemical processes, so biochemical processes and interfaces. So, and when we did this, we also understood that distillation is an area where we need to be absolutely world-class and fermentation, two areas, because fermentation then would start to touch many, many dimensions of our life, whether it is on food, whether it is on pharma, whether it is on energy or on all the three in a different sort of time frame. But fermentation will become very basic technology to what we'll do. So we started to focus on ensuring that our vision of bringing agriculture to industry and focusing on that, but through technology route, not through take a steel plate and weld and bend and then give it back to the marketplace. That was not our approach.
So who do you think, you know, will come to you closest in the competition or capability?
Well, that's a great question. That's a great question. So for whatever reason, and I think maybe it was the vision, That's the only answer I can find. The vision was, I need to be able to solve the problem for the customer and not offer what I have. And I think that solution-oriented approach, which has been ingrained from day one, has what has led us to create a situation which allows us to be very unique. There is no competition of ours which offers the whole TEMPO model, as I call it, technology, engineering, manufacturing, projects, and O&M. The TEMPO model is not offered by a single. For every block, there's a T competition, there's an E competition, there's an M competition, there's a P competition, there's a O competition. And maybe there's some who do two or three of them, but nobody does all the five. So that is the one huge differentiator for us. Then of course, depending on the business that we are in, so if you're in water in India, ZLD, we have Ion Exchange and VATEC and Thermax is our competition. We have, if you are chemical process equipment system, then I compete with L&T and then I compete with some others in the country who are good at these kind of things. We also compete in that business. We compete with absolutely international players. We play big time competition with Chinese because lots of companies that focus on skid manufacturing are focused on China. Of late, it has changed. So we compete and win against Chinese competition. And that's where our differentiation starts because we are able to bring an engineering strength that is not necessarily very easy to match. So that's another business area. Within the ethanol space, For 2G, there are, for second version ethanol, we have two or three international companies that are all, practically all of us are at a similar stage right now of demonstration of the technology. No commercial scale for anybody yet, but everybody is in the stage of building. So Clariant, Xsens in France, Clariant in Austria. So we are able to, we are competing with these guys. In the 1G space, depending on the market, if it's America, it's ICM. If it's Europe, then we have Megan and a couple of others. In India, there are some, unfortunately for us, these are the guys who are ex-Praj. But they are small. They have not grown into large organizations. They have stayed where they are. So it's different competition across different business scales.
It's basically, as you're saying, it's a unique company with a very, very diverse set of capabilities, and you know, and hence offers, you know, a sustainable potential to capture different those opportunities, and most of them are straddling across the futuristic sort of technologies or growth drivers.
Correct.
Right. So, you know, just coming, and we will go into, you know, from coming to ethanol, I think, you know, that's considered to be right now the best and biggest opportunity, and rightfully after long it has come, and government has advanced the, you know, the blending guideline. So I think that's a great opportunity for you. So if, first of all, I think, you know, how large it can become for us, what kind of market share you can capture in this? And also you talked about your combiform fermentation technology, which is a kind of novel technology, and which you believe that it enhances the ethanol yield, right, as compared to your competition. So how different it is from the conventional fermentation, and you know, would you have incremental edge over the competition because of this?
Yes, because very important is to understand that when you take any biomass, and if you are a user, you are a producer of end product, you want to make sure that for every ton of input that I get inside, I get the highest yield. That is one of the key requirements for you as a plant operator, right? Or as a plant owner. And that is where, and fermentation is where it starts, because that's where you start separating sugars from the feedstock, which is then you further ferment. So our technology is really cut above the others in terms of the way we have approached, we have understood, we have formalized our technology on the fermentation side. And I'll give an example. We are right now working with a company in Nordic countries where we signed, you probably know, we have announced a collaboration company called CCAB in Sweden. CCAB developed a technology at initial scale for taking forest residues and converting them to ethanol. But they realized that it will take much more to commercialize the technology. And then we work with them. We have partnered with them now. And we have now come up with a new improved technology that incorporates inputs from us on the fermentation side of the technology, apart from others as well, which is allowing us to actually make it scalable at commercial level. Otherwise, this was a technology that would never have seen light at the end of the day. But now with our intervention and our programming of fermentation, we are able to go to that level. So this is just an illustration, but fermentation has been at very core of what we are developing right now. And this will hold us good, not only here, but we believe also in our high purity business, because that is where we also see a lot more focus now shifting to fermentation with the big drive on vaccinations all across the world, as well as the big role that biopharma is expected to play, so which is fundamentally fermentation.
How large do you see this opportunity becoming for you? And secondly, if your yield is better than everybody else, then practically speaking, you should have 100% market share, right? Why anybody should go for anybody else?
Well, just retreating back to the answer, so in terms of how large is the domestic opportunity on the ethanol side, I think that was part of your question earlier as well, is that today we produce roughly 400 crore liters of ethanol in the country, mostly based on sugary feedstocks. If we have to meet the E20 targets, we'll have to add 1,000 crore liters of ethanol to this 400, so we'll go to 1,400 level. This 1,000 crore liters has to come from some feedstocks, right? And sugary feedstocks are not going to be enough. So this 400 may probably travel to about 500, 600, 650 level, not more than that. But what will happen is almost equal capacity, 650 equivalent capacity will get built on the starchy feedstocks, right? 650 crore liters of starchy feedstocks. Now, if you put this all into our space, you say, yeah, all those are liter numbers. What does it mean to Praj? Well, so the Praj universe that opens up is almost 14,000 crores of investment for us, right? And this 14,000 crore investment, when this rolls out, will mean that at about, this is the potential of the whole thing. And we are saying, assume, and we are not working towards that. We are working towards a different program, but assume that our market share remains where it is. Even then, 2/3 of this capacity will come our way. So nearly 10,000 crores will walk the way towards Praj in terms of our business opportunity. We are, of course, focusing on a program to say, how do I increase my market share, which is true for any leader. So that's the size of the domestic opportunity. There is a lot of other stuff that's happening. For example, Canada is about to announce an E10 program for their economy, and then subsequently E20. So that will lead to a large spike in demand over the next 5 to 7 years. Europe has already announced the RED II, under which second generation ethanol will be required in equal quantity to the entire first generation ethanol that is produced today on the continent. So I think we will see a lot of activity that is happening on driving the whole ethanol equation forward over the next foreseeable future. And with our strong positions, with references, it is going to be a very, very exciting time ahead for us.
So if you know, and maybe you can address this later, but if the, you know, suddenly opportunity is coming in such a big way, it's kind of a J curve, is Praj as an organization ready to, you know, capture this, you know, from a capacity perspective? Because you are talking about domestic market, international market, there would be some constraint on the capacity.
Yes. So we are aware that we cannot just sit here and then say, yeah, everything will happen. It's just a matter of getting an order book. Surely we have to be very strongly focused on delivering that order book in its rightness. So over the last 5-10 years, when we have had some very difficult times to cope with, one thing the company never did was to reduce its spend on R&D. We continued to spend the same amount of money, so which takes a lot of vision on the part of founders to actually commit. They could take an easy way out, which they did not, and they said, no, let's stay committed. So that is going to stand us in good deed, because that allows us to. So that's number one. Number two, which is equally important, is from that stand onwards, where is it that, so technology is there. Then we go to the engineering prowess, and we are very, very cognizant of the fact that a large part of our deliverable is around engineering. So we have launched a massive initiative inside the company, not now, almost 8 months over now, for using the power of on the prowess of IT to digitalize our operation, to standardize our offerings, because we don't have, even if we customize a plant for customer, it could still have standard components. I don't have to engineer every time a new distillation tower. I can pick from the list that we have. So just to give an idea, we have over the years, we have engineered distillation towers of different capacity, and we have now 175 models of them. I don't have to discuss 176 now. I can pick one from there, right? But that will need some engineering tools to be able to pick from the past. So we've done that. So we are now pushing a direction of let's standardize, let's reduce the variety, so that also becomes easy for us on the inventory and the factory side, the manufacturing side. On the other hand, use the prowess to speed up the execution on the engineering side. We are also tying up with, we are enhancing our own capabilities in the complex engineering areas, but we are also tying up with certain partners on a dedicated basis, so they will be available to us for engineering. When you go to manufacturing, again, full focus is on modernization of the shop floor and automation, and not on enhancing the square meter area. So we believe from the same piece of land, we should be able to get much more output through automation, through digitalization, through process flow management. And we are also saying that what is not high value add, that we will move to dedicated vendors, and what is very high value add and IP related protected items, that we will build inside. So that's on this. Similarly, we are scaling up on the execution side as well, because at sites we'll have to do different models will come up. We are tying up with companies to see that they will become repetitive contractors for us. We don't have to do every time, and so on. So it is a thought out plan. Right now, we don't foresee a big capital expense the way we have thought our strategy, at least not for the next 3 years, where we need to put. But if at all a capital expense comes, it will come on the R&D side, but not on the...
Great. And coming to now CBG, which again, you know, is a very big opportunity. It just has come about. I mean, need of that is not to be discussed because I think already there. So my question to you, I think currently you seem to be the only or the dominant, I would say probably only player who's ready with the capability and, you know, with a lot more delivery. I mean, you also have this differentiated, as I understand, you know, Praj's DBO biomethanation process versus continuous stirred reactor process. So if you can, you know, also tell us again on a similar level that how large this opportunity can become for Praj and how differentiated we are, what are our advantages vis-a-vis the some of the competition there. You know, while you are miles ahead in that, but still, you know, would love to get your process and perspective on that.
Correct. So Vikas, on CBG business, I think before I answer the question on what's in for Praj, I think what's very important to understand is that nowhere in the world such a program exists. This is the first time anywhere in the world a program of this scale or this size is being attempted by the policymakers. So that itself is the first. Then recognition that we as a country, we do not have a gas infrastructure. We are more liquid fuel infrastructure. We do not have a gas infrastructure today. So retailing outlets, the gas pipelines, the CGD networks are all under award right now, if I can use that word. You know, they are not even started to function. Very, very, very few initial ones have started to function. There are other issues around the way the taxation laws are, the way the safety laws are, because nobody has seen a product called CBG earlier, right? While in some of the countries like Germany or in the United States, the biogas was being produced out of waste. Most of the time, the application is either on the power generation or in localized heating application because of the fact that they're very cold countries. So nobody has gone to a purified form of biogas, which is what we are attempting to do at CBG, that it is even more potent and higher potential than a CNG molecule. So the CBG molecule today, if you put into your tank, in a gas tank, it will give higher mileage compared to a CNG molecule. That is how this has been specified. So I think what is important is, A, first of all, the whole infrastructure needs to come into being because the problem that gas has is that you can't store it. Yeah. I mean, the maximum storage you can have is one day. You can't have it more than that. It's just unviable. So unless the dispensation and the mechanism comes into place simultaneously, it will be very difficult to start just creating plants that produce gas. Where will you take that gas? You can just tear it up the stack.
Yeah.
So it's a simultaneous development and maybe infrastructure to lead a little bit compared to gas. Some laws also, but the good news is that there is a lot of work that is happening in that direction. And now we are seeing laws being now enacted to see that you can pump it into CGD pipelines. You know, there are laws about how what can you use as a fuel, what you can't use, what you can pump, what you can't pump. So those things are now being clarified. There are a whole host of actions that is required around the co-products because the CBG production process also produces high-grade fertilizer. So, but it is high-grade fertilizer because the scientists think so, but the lawmakers think so. Then they have to notify. Then only you can sell it out as a farmer, to a farmer as a fertilizer. So there are many of these. So the co-product laws are being rolled out now. So the whole ecosystem is under development for CBG at this stage. That's number one. Number two, if anybody says, yeah, I want to see what does it look, what does this animal look like? Well, there is nowhere to show. I just came back from a trip I was mentioning to you earlier. So the first plant that we are commissioning in the country right now of this size. And we are also understanding as to what it will take to take it to the full scale operation. We are not too far away from it. Maybe in another 6 weeks time, we will be in a position to go to a full scale operation for that plant. It is already producing at half. The gas is being sold at a IOCL established gas outlet. People are already filling it into the vehicle. So it is beginning to develop. But we are also understanding that you can't switch it on and on day one, it produces 100% and it dispenses 100%. That doesn't happen. So the good news is that we are also, as we were talking earlier, our technology, our run gas process that we have is very, very unique. It is expected to produce at least 30% higher yield compared to anybody else in the market today. And that comes from this innate knowledge and investment that we have done in the microbial side of the technology over the years that I was mentioning earlier. So that is what is going to differentiate us very strongly
early days yet, but maybe a year down the line, we'll be able to see a much more clear picture of how the market develops. Government wants to do it. It's a viable proposition. The feedstock is ample. So the technology is very much there. But we now need to see the proof of technology, the development of ecosystem, and some more policy clarifications around that. And I think that is what we're taking.
So how large is this market space for you? And is there any competition in this for you?
Well, there's always, in fact, there should be competition. Otherwise, there is no fun. Right? there is no fun. If you're the only game in the town, then it doesn't work. So we are seeing some guys trying to put up small plants and bringing in small technology, but we don't see yet a large scale. There are two announcements made, one around a Netherlands company coming in and one around a German company, which is first trying to establish its own plant in India. Because they want to sell gas. They don't want to sell the technology for others. So in terms of putting plant for others, we are the only guys who are doing it right now at big scale. We are doing for HPCL, for the rice straw. We have done for another customer, IPL, for based on press mud. We are doing one on spent wash for one of our distillery customers here near Pune. So, but these are the initial plants that will tell how things work and what needs to be done. I think once we are past that phase, then we'll be able to comment. The government wants to put up 5,000 plants. The 5,000 plants translate to 175,000 crore opportunity for investment. So that those are very large numbers. Okay. Is it possible one fine day for India to have 5,000 plants? Answer is yes. It is possible for India to have 5,000 plants. When will it happen? How fast we can take it there? I think these are too early days yet. It's like saying when a child is born, will he be a scientist? I think this is early days.
I think saying scientist is like too, if it is that early, I think then probably it's too early. But I guess here we have crossed a lot of stages, right? At least, he has taken admission in BSc. Is that not?
Well, yeah, that probably born is a little exaggeration. But what I want to say is that a lot of work has to happen around the ecosystem development, because that's a very critical element. And that is not something that we control. Right. But it is happening wherever we have seen. But I think some demonstrations are necessary. And right now, it is in that phase of demonstrating what works.
And what is a typical project cycle in this, if I were to...
12 months.
So it's not that, a long process also.
It's not very long.
Yeah. Okay, great. Now, coming to other great next futuristic thing you talked about is BioPrism, right? I mean... we are in the sustainability and the renewable thing is the talk of the town, I guess, in the world, right? It's a big thing, right? And renewable chemicals and materials are, I think, the future where the future belongs, right? And you again have taken a lot of lead. As I was reading in one of your, that you have taken 10,000 agri feedstock sample across the world and you have innate knowledge of them and this market right now is only $65 billion, but growing aggressively at, mid-teens and can become very big. And as about almost 90% of the fossil fuel chemistry is possible to replace with this, right? So would love to get your sense around, because this is where, again, the whole science and comes into play and your capability comes into play. So how do you see this evolving? What are the big picture, big opportunities out here, time frame, or is it too early, or we are just broadly your thoughts on that, please?
So because we have two platforms, biomobility, which is all these fuels that we talked about so far, the ethanol and the gas and the aviation fuel and marine fuel and things, and there are more future fuels coming there as well, biomethanol, biohydrogen, they will all walk in now as time progresses. On the other hand, when we made the announcement to BioPrism, that was actually indicating that we are no longer only a bioenergy company. We'll also be a company that plays play in this very, very important space of renewable chemical materials. As you rightly said, that's a fast expanding market. And we do foresee that the future will demand much, much more dimensions of sustainability from producers. The people who want to use products that have not being detrimental to environment and so on. So while these are early days, I think what has to happen is we have said we want to work in that space. We have started investing our time, effort, and money into that space. We have formed a very, very high level advisory board that is formed of some of the leading experts in the world who are advising us on what we should do and how we should go forward in this space. There are other companies as well who are trying to get into this space. The idea is to find the process and the molecule that you want to address, and how do you, you know, lead the transformation from through your process from starting from a feedstock. We understand the feedstock and the agriculture feedstocks very well, as you mentioned, and that's a strength that we'll be able to play with. There's a microbial engineering and technology that we have. That's another strength that we'll be able to play with. And our understanding of how plants get built and constructed. So I think those three will come into a strong play for us as even as we participate and dialogue with some of the partners on this in this space to see what is the most optimal way of going about. So is it bioplastics? So there is biofood, which I was mentioning earlier, which is fermentation related food products. There could be bioplastics or fermentation related all the chemicals downstream of the crude oil refineries that we see today. Most of them can actually get replicated through this route. The question, of course, is that at the end of the day, these are commodity chemicals, so they need to be competing in the same space and on the same consumer demand. So we'll have to get to a stage of technology where we are able to meet the market demands and expectation in terms of both volume, process stability, and pricing point for these commodity chemicals. Having said that, world is going to move towards bioplastics is a foregone conclusion. That's something that we also understand in our research that we have done. And we believe that over a period of time, we will be able to transit. At this stage, I think it's a bit of premature for me to say anything around what will the numbers pan out to be, what will look out to be. But definitely, Praj has made a move to say that RCM will be an important part of our portfolio and research. And as we go forward, we will talk about it.
Okay. And I think, you know, somehow, you know, Praj is now right now being seen only an ethylene and, you know, CBG kind of focused company. But I think there are two, three other interesting, you know, businesses, which according to me should see a very sort of aggressive growth in times to come, because in India, CapEx cycle has really picked up after a really long awaited time. So specifically, I think on the zero liquid discharge and critical process equipment, because those are the two areas where Praj has always had historically also reasonably good capability. So, you know, are you seeing any kind of accelerated growth on that? And should we be, you know, what's your thought on that?
Yes. So zero liquid discharge is an area where we believe that as we progress through time, more and more industries would start focusing on zero liquid discharge. We are already seeing metals and mining, oil and gas, downstream chemicals, specialty chemicals, food and beverages. Some of these segments are already very strongly focused because of the law on zero liquid discharge. I think there's also a growing understanding that water is a stress resource and we need to do everything within our prowess to ensure that we are able to recover as much as we can and not just discharge it out for all other reasons of managing the biodiversity downstream, etc., etc. So ZLD will find, we, as you are aware, in December last year, we announced one of the largest orders that was awarded for us to build a zero liquid discharge system for a very large organization, IOCL, for their downstream chemical project near Baroda refinery. As the laws become stringent, we will see more and more companies moving to ZLD, and that should open up the space for us. Today, we are limiting ourselves to India because we felt that we must first establish, because these are complex projects which need very deep understanding, not only of the technology, but also the laws of the land that come into play. And we believe that we will acquire enough strength over a period of time to not only build, so first we build these big systems in India. And then once we are strong around it, then we will also want to see what we can do in the international market, especially with those customers with whom we are already working in India. So if you really look at our customer list today, there is like who's who, Coca-Cola, Pepsi, Aditya Birla Group, JSW Steel, to name a few, who are some of the large pharma companies, multinational pharma companies. So we're already working with some of those customers because these are the people who have a strong sustainability focus and who want to do what is good for the ecology. If I can use that word, not only for the economy, but also for the ecology. And so these are our customers. So when they go outside, so if a Pepsi plant in India is very similar to a Pepsi plant anywhere else in the world, so why can't we do it for them there, what we do here? But that's a little far away. But today we are very focused on India. On the CPS business that you talked about, we have very strongly focused on working with leaders in select segments in the world. So these are the technology companies who value the fact that we can engineer their technology and manufacture complex set of equipments for them, given our progress in manufacturing. So engineering and manufacturing is the offering in that space where we are able to conceptualize a plant and put it in a skid. Okay, we can conceptualize a very complex heat exchanger, engineer it and build it for them. And some of the customers that we work with there are people in the space. I'll just give some example. We have Baker Hughes as our customers who are leaders in oil and gas. We have Schlumberger in oil and gas. We have Air Products in industrial gases space. So these are just some of BASF. Some of these guys are absolutely the top end in their business segments. And we took a strategy to work with them, and we've been investing into our relationship with them over the last 3 to 5 years. And then we believe that as time is now coming around, where we'll start to see the results of that coming as well, because a lot of companies are now focusing on clean tech and green tech, and their technology is one, but then how do you put it on ground? And that is where this business unit will play a specific role to engineer and manufacture and put it on ground.
Great. So it's fair to say that you have, you know, four big engines propelling your ship right now at a fast speed.
Huge. Yeah, I will say that we have four pearls that make the necklace. There are on the sideline, and we'll see how they look.
Yeah. And I hope many more are in making. So now let me turn to the, you know, another most exciting part, which I always personally believe that, you know, is that the when there are many technology companies who have huge potential, but you always need a great managerial capability and capacity to execute those potential, because potential otherwise will remain potential and you won't be able to unleash. And at least what we saw, you know, Praj, before you joined, of course, it was always the way we saw, at least it was always a very, very technically sound company, but somehow it always lacked in terms of on the focus, execution and delivery. And that you know, and you know, I have also personally tracked Praj for 15 years, and it has, so you know, it had acquired. So, and in last 2-3 years, we have seen a distinct change in how Praj is kind of conducting itself. The organizational energy is, you know, can be felt, and you know, we have interacted with people at different levels. So when we feel that it's a very, very different organization. So would love to get your perspective. What has led to this sort of transformation? Of course, you know, Mr. Chaudhary has always led it from the front, on the technology front. But I think in the last couple of years, you and Sachin has transformed the execution capability. So would love to get your perspective, because that, according to us, is most critical in terms of how whether you will succeed or will be able to capture this great tailwind you have or not.
So Vikas, you know, I think the transformation is a process. So it's not like a day's event or anything like that. So over a period of time, I think if I go back, maybe 2010 is when the first decision was taken in the company to bring in a professional managing director in the company, right? So probably that's where, and maybe even a couple of years before that, the seed was there in the head of the founders to say, okay, we need to manage differently as we grow go forward. The R&D center was just about set up at that time. The Praj Matrix, of which we are so proud of today, was set up in 2008-09. So in many ways, the seeding or the thought process was already visible over a period of time. The whole focus on internationalization of the business, or building of the R&D center, or starting to bring in a managing director in 2010 onwards. And even, you know, one of the fascinating thing about Praj is it's always experimenting. It is not necessarily stuck to a particular idea. And I think that's the strength. And to me, the biggest strength that the company has built over the period of time, for different reasons, and I'll go into a couple of them, is that we are a very resilient organization. Okay, this is amazing. There are certain elements in the organization which you'd say, how can this be? You know, but that is what actually represents our resilience. We will never give up. We will never be negative. We will never deviate from our vision. You know, if whatever our vision is, we believe, you know, that's exactly what we should be doing. even when surrounding numbers sometimes tell us that no, they would cast some doubt in your head. But we are saying no. The vision is that was set long ago is still true because it was really visionary. Yeah, it is our job. And I'll give a simple example. So when I joined 3 years ago, you know, as is wont for all the newly joined CEOs who don't have much idea about the business, but who can do some, you know, Excel sheets and graphs and PowerPoints, etc. So I did it. And I know I along with one of my colleagues who was working in strategy office, and I showcased to, I went to Dr. Chaudhary and I told him, I said, sir, you know, our people cost to our sales is completely out of the park compared to any other company in that we compare ourselves with. I'm just giving an example. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, we must power down the people. This was my dialogue with him. And, you know, he gave me a gem of a reply. He said, Shishir, do you know why I've hired you? He said, I've hired you so that you will create opportunities so that these people's potential can be put to good use. It shows thinking, right? Very different way of thinking. It was so easy for him to say, yeah, solve ho, nikal do, apna profit bad jayega. But that's not what he said. And then as you start to understand the company deeply, you understand that we are a company that is uniquely made. So there are all of us take up jobs, especially people like us who are professionals who then pick up jobs, and all our employees for that matter. It's an amazing group of people who have bought into the cause. They are married to the cause of sustainability. They are the people who actually want, I mean, you'll be amazed to see the number of volunteering stuff that our people do. Even when the pandemic grows, so many people came out and they did not look at their personal lives. They did not look at their personal agendas. They just went out and served. That is who we are, right? So it's a band of purpose-driven employees, which has come together. It attracts people. You were mentioning about me joining from an MNC here. One of the reasons I joined is because I bought into the cause. I was very passionate about the cause, saying, no, this is a great business that needs to grow because we need to do something for the future generations. And I have absolutely no hesitation in saying that all this has culminated over a period of time into where we are today. Yes, I and Sachin came. We were able to bring some focus, and that anybody will do, right? Otherwise, we won't be able to earn our salaries. But given that fact, I think what really helped us was an organization that was extremely resilient, a company that was true to its vision, which did not want to deviate from it, and the fact that it had already decided to work with a process of transformation. Because transformation, as I knew, is a process of change, and therefore any change would get very quickly resisted and then will get delayed. But what has helping us right now is, in that sense, we are lucky that we are inheriting a changing organization. Having said that, we also realize that as we move forward, we will have to meet a different set of expectations from different set of stakeholders, right? We cannot continue to be living inside a bubble, because then we will not survive. So three or four things that we did has helped us to chart out the course. As I mentioned, there are different pearls on our string, but we told each pearl that each of you is an independent company. That is one rule that we set, I and Sachin set for them. Ki bhai, there is a corporate called Sachin, but he only takes money. He doesn't give money. Okay. He will only take it from you. He will not give it to you. So you please become independent on it. And I think this understanding that by becoming independent on free cash flow, you will actually drive a lot of process changes in the way you manage your business. That was one big change that we brought about. And I'm very happy to say that all our leaders have really, really responded to that demand from us very, very well. The second thing that we did was that we also said that we should focus on high potential geographies. That is how the move to Brazil, the move to United States for 1G business, the ZLD segment in India, the very focused top leaders, although we knew it will take a little more time, but with CPS on focusing some of those relationships and investing them into deeply to get a strategic supplier status. Some of these things, so high potential territories, and territories could be geographies, could be customer segments, technology segments, was something that we felt that was very, very good for us to start focusing on, because that will help us to build a very sustainable company. And we knew that we could meet and beat any competition, because we are meeting and beating them in other parts of the world. The third thing that we very strongly focused on was, you know, we are a very strong technology company, but one of the big issues in many technology companies is that you have a technology and then there's a market, and how quickly can you take your technology to the market that you develop, and how, in what kind of a robust way. Already a system was put in place recognizing the need for this. So we have R&D, but we also have a center that looks at innovation and applied technology, application technology. So they are very focused on application of the technology that we have developed. We just put in some processes to see how we can do a faster and time-bound commercialization of technology. Some of the new intervention that we have done now on improving and solving customers' problem on reduction in spent waste generation in 2G in ethanol production processes, making them energy independent on their own, so they don't have to depend on external fuel. We've taken several steps in that direction now, just to example, to see how we can bridge the, so technology is developed, how fast can we commercialize it was another one. How do we speed up the whole process of taking. The next thing that we did was we were very clear that we need to focus very strongly on execution. So the way our management process was on execution side and the manufacturing, on site management, on the whole, once the order comes in, how do we go about it? We created some positions in the organizations. We brought in a sort of centralized focus. Rather than it being a team effort, it became a driven effort. We switched our processes from to a weekly review. So every week, the whole thing gets reviewed rather than once in a month or once in a quarter. So some very focused effort with some supply chain members. So we thought that we had to do a whole thing around execution to make sure that what we have, then we don't want it to, with customers as well, because sometimes our customers were saying, let the equipment lie with you. But our equipments are massive in size. So if they lie with us, they occupy my shop floor. And then I can't produce the next one. So we also produced a very close monitoring and dialogue with our customers on progress of that equipment. And last but not the least, I think we decided there is no company in the world which will say, I'm not customer centric. Everybody says I'm customer centric, right? And that's the good thing to do. But we said, what does it mean? If we say we are customer centric, then what does it mean? Does it mean that we resolve complaints in a shortest period of time? Does it mean that we take our innovation fastest to the market? Does it mean that there's a listening post for the customers to air their grievances? Does it mean that we are able to engage with them on a strategic level to say, what are your strategic problems you want to solve so that I can work on that now rather than being a reactive? So there are many dimensions, right? We don't want to develop a technology that no customer. So do we have a customer behind the technology development saying, okay, I'm part of this development dialogue. So, and understanding, making this understood across the organization, not only at the senior level. So that has been another effort that we've undertaken to take forward. And last but not the least, very unique, because there is no other Praj. Okay, because there is no other Praj, we have to make sure that we keep our employees very highly engaged. Because for me to make up for a lost employee is a very high cost. Okay, and understanding that ethos of saying that we have a strong set of people who are experientially very strong, who are conceptually embedded into this whole system, we are able to take good care of that. But how, one is to take good care, another is to get them engaged at a higher energy level. And I think that is what we are doing, and we have done several, not that it was not an attempt in the past, it's now that with the businesses also sort of pushing them in the right direction, it in that sense it works as a lubricant for us. So that has been our journey. Sachin brought in a very important dimension of risk management. So how do we ensure that we don't end up committing ourselves to, because new technology is always exciting, but then it can also lead you to some risk that you need not enter into. So a strong focus on process management rather than individually based management. And a strong sort of risk management culture has been brought about in the country, in the company, and that is what is helping us to move forward. I hope I sort of...
I think you covered fairly, and I think all of them, if one were to discuss in detail, you can spend hours, and which we have done, with you over many, discussions and meetings, and that's what has given us the confidence. I mean, we've always believed, the management plays a big role. And for the interest of our viewers, we have a framework what we call IMPRESS, and we rate each management on that, which stands for integrity, modest and, you know, capable, passionate and driven, realistic but aggressive, efficient capital allocator, skin in the game, and strong governance and risk management system. So in some sense, you have covered all of them. And when we looked at, you know, this management team, we rated them almost close to 5, which is our highest rating. So, I mean, that's what has given us the confidence over the, you know, over last couple of years in looking at the Praj. And that's what has been part of our magic story. Two last questions, and, you know, then I'll probably take a few questions from the audience. And I'm trying to cover some of them in my conversation. From where you are sitting, you have, you know, obviously driver's view of, you know, the industry, organization, everything. How would you envision Praj, you know, in 5 years? What's your vision of Praj in 5 years?
Well, I think we are very clearly seeing ourselves at the forefront of this whole, what we call it, economy 5.0. You know, 4.0 was about AI and automation, but we believe that 5.0 will definitely have a large element of what I would call as change in our resources and much more sustainable development oriented resources utilization in our daily life. And we see ourselves at the forefront of that, that change and the revolution that we believe will happen. The pandemic has taught us very differently that we need to honor the nature in a very different way than what we've been doing as a mankind. And I think that is that augurs well, because as we move forward to this, driven by net zero emissions or by carbon intensity reduction solutions, I think what were the back-end calculations so far, saying, okay, please tell me what's the calculation of carbon footprint, this will now become the leader. This will lead the solutions from our end, where we say, you want to reduce the carbon footprint by so much, come talk to us. Okay. We see ourselves as playing our role in the world, still at the back of a technology, still staying true to our values, and ensuring that we tomorrow, if further 20 years down the line, somebody were to look back and write, they would say with pride that, you know, there's a company called Praj that played its role, and there is a company that Praj that played its role 20 years ago as well. So that's the way we see ourselves.
But we are all financial investors, right? So this is a qualitative part, but, you know, you told me 3 years ago, gold mine hai, right? But now where are you in that stage? Where are you in that journey? How large it can become? Can it become 5x? Can it? Because see, you know, I mean, again, it is, you know, who knows? I mean, like you said, it's a very big opportunity, but how do you see that, you know, in terms of size and scale?
I mean, the way I look at it is like this, Vikas, that if you look at our last year's order book that we finished the year with, and we said that, well, what our order book is, almost 1,000 crores is based on bioenergy, roughly the number that we gave, right? And I just told you, we calculated and we said that there's a 10,000 crore opportunity that is unfolding over the next 3 years, right? So one can do the mathematics, put these numbers together. We have no intention to lose our market share. We are only expanding. We are not going to remain on a one pearl story. We are going to be multiple pearls in our strings. Every business. So some businesses will grow where we are high market share, but there's a big tailwind for us. The ecosystem is developing favorably. In some of our other businesses where we are starting out now, we are not a majority market share player. We are one of the players. And that is where we believe that our technological strength will also help us establish to that position 4-5 years from now. So whether the number would be a 3x or a 5x, time will tell, right? All I can tell you is that we are not looking back at all. We are only looking forward, and looking forward to a very bright future.
Great. And, you know, final question on this from my side, what are the risks to this you see? You know, because ultimately we have to always watch out for the risk.
Yes. Great question. So I think very clearly it is the core business for ours depends on the fact that there is an ethanol market out there. It's a fact, right? That's our core business that depends. And that is driven from the changes in the ecosystem. Currently, the system is indicating that everything is positive and is moving in the right direction. That's number one. Number two, I think beyond 25, the market for ethanol has to expand. We have talked about it, but there's a diesel blending program that can come on the way. We are working very closely with ARAI to make that happen. So if that happens, that gives the next fillip on the ethanol side. How do we iterate our technology? And if we don't iterate our technology, is a risk. If we don't develop enough technological interventions to convert the ethanol, which is one of the basic molecules, to something different, say sustainable aviation fuel or a bioplastic, as the case may be, then we would not have delivered justice, and that would be a risk to businesses' growth. Up to next 4 or 5 years, it's a different cup of tea, but beyond that, it's a different cup of tea. So we will have to invest, and not investing is a risk, and we will invest into developing technologies that will take us beyond 25 in that sense. That is number one. In the immediate future, right now, I think, and because you said you're a numbers community, so everybody would be wanting, so what's going to happen to you if the commodity prices keep going northward? So it will impact. There is no question that in the near term, the commodity price rise, the restricted mobility of people on account of COVID, so till that is resolved, the disruptions in supply chains because of pandemic is, and some of the businesses not sustaining themselves. I think these are clear risks for us. Maybe it is for some other businesses as well. We are understanding them, the nature of them, and then trying to solve a problem. For example, we are building a very important reactor for one of the customers in the United States for a very important drug making. And one of the important components, subcontractor, he has a repeated case of COVID outbreak in his plant. So we're just stuck because we can't move forward right now. That's something that we had not foreseen. So those are short-term risks that will keep coming, okay? The other use is how fast the technology sort of progresses on the other front. So for example, automotive technology. How fast will we see a hydrogen-driven engine as a normal engine in two-wheelers and four-wheelers, right? That's another technological change that can happen. We have a speed by which we are developing our foray into biohydrogen. But that needs to compete with any other form of hydrogen. But that needs to also then get compatible with the speed of development on the automotive segment, because that's where most of the biofuel is used. So how will that progress? Will that progress at a speed which is 2 times our speed, or which we'll be able to keep up with that speed, or we'll be ahead of time? Those are some of the risks that we'll have to overcome. As to the, it is a fact that the fuel system will change. The energy usage patterns will change in the economies across the world. Our challenge or risk would be how fast can we change and keep up with the ahead of it, for that matter.
Sure. Now, let me just take three, four questions from the audience. Let me just, and if somebody wants to ask in person, please raise your hand. And meanwhile, I'll kind of read it from the chat. So there's one question from Nilatri. There's a market buzz about Reliance getting into ethanol production. Would this move help Praj Industries' business growth in times come, or it will be detrimental?
Then from what we know is they will produce ethanol. So we are very happy. We will be very happy to be the technology engineering tempo supplier to them. If they want to set up a ethanol plant for themselves. We are not ethanol producers ourselves, so we are not competing with them. We are only going to enable them to produce. So I don't see that. I'd see that to be a positive development as in when they decide to move.
Okay. A couple of questions from Sajal Kapoor. Bioagriculture is a new area of development. What are the key products developed in terms of biopesticides and biofertilizer?
Okay, so currently we are working on the byproducts that happen out of our processes. So one of the key areas that is going to produce biofertilizer is CBG. So CBG produces both liquid and solid form of fertilizer. We have already got these certified by NOCA, which is the premier certifying agency for that. We have also started to do some field trials with these, because now that it's becoming available at our first site in terms of what is happening. The good news for us is that we are also the first CBG plant that we are commissioning also happens to be owned by one of the largest fertilizer companies in India. So they are very knowledgeable about what needs to be done. So we are also working with them to learn as to what needs to happen in terms of fortification, etc. On the other hand, we have technologies developed because fortification is very microbial activity. So we will be able to bring some of our microbial development knowledge to fortification of these fertilizers and take it forward.
Purity in vaccine development globally, fermentation solutions for both microbial and mammalian.
Yes. So Praj High Purity is now beginning to offer fermentation solutions to, and it's one of the important members in the supply chain of the vaccine. So while I'm not at liberty to give names out for the reasons that we have signed agreements, but to, enough to tell you that they are not only, they are supplying high purity water systems, they are supplying the process systems, but they're also supplying the fermentation systems for what should I say, for manufacture of elements that go into manufacture of vaccine. That's number one. Number two, we are also strongly focused on complex injectables as a space in which several of our solutions are being offered. And that is where we believe that we have a very, we have now built a track record that, and we have worked with some absolute leading firms in the world, in India for that matter, and even some outside to actually build that prowess that we are the partners that they can rely upon. So as we move forward, we'll see. And the third thing is PHS, Praj High Purity System as we call it. PHS is also now working with our R&D to understand what elements of our fermentation knowledge can be brought to the fore in this case.
Fermentative protein is a nice emerging trend. What sort of opportunity landscape do you see in fermentation space as biopharma leader in India is planning to add another 1 million liters of fermentation?
Sorry, I couldn't get the question.
So alternative protein is a nice emerging space. And what sort of opportunity landscape do you see in fermentation space? Partly, I think you answered, but...
Correct. So as I said, fermentation will have in space in food, and we see a lot of activity that will start to unfold there. Also in pharma, and then also in energy. And very clearly, we've been very energy focused and now stepping into the pharma space as well. There was a dialogue earlier about whether we want to go to the biofood side, but that is still something that is still what I would call is on discussion table, if I can use that word.
Okay. Indian government has set up a steep target for blending 20% ethanol in automobile fuel in the next 2 years, but is the auto industry endorsing this move, and how prepared they are to implement the changes in the vehicle design to accommodate this ethanol blending fuel?
Yeah, so I think this one notification that came created a bit of a confusion. So the 20% target is for 25, not for 23. It is for 25. From 23, they can start to blend up to 20%. That is what it says. So that you could have a state or a depot which can blend up to 20%, but the countrywide target of 20% will be achieved, is targeted to be achieved in 2025. So that's number one. Number two, the automakers will have to get very clearly involved because they are a very important player in the whole game. But what is very important is that the existing car park, as the automotive terminology calls, is far larger than the new vehicles being added, right? And they will become the users as well. So the existing population of the vehicles is far outstrips the supply per year, right? So that's the second dimension. The third dimension is, of course, we have to make sure that the emission standards are met. And for that, a work has to happen, which will mean up to 20% of blending, as from my knowledge and understanding. What needs to happen is that in order to realize the, let me backtrack a little bit. Ethanol is an oxygen-releasing agent. So when you burn ethanol in the combustion chamber with petrol, it releases oxygen, okay, which is very good for combustion of petrol. And utilizing this property, you can actually design new engines with much higher compression ratios. Higher compression ratios would mean higher efficiency and so on. But there is already an existing set of vehicles which are not like that. Okay, so because they are not designed for high compression ratios, they are designed for lower compression ratios because of the fact that they are using petrol as base fuel for design, and they want to take care of the knocking and other properties that happen. So as we move forward, we have to make sure that we are in a position to very clearly transit to an economy where people are able to use E20 to its best possible efficiency. At E20, probably the fuel line components in existing vehicles I'm talking about, or even the new ones, the fuel line components and the gaskets will have to undergo change to realize the best performance. It's not that the car won't start. It's just
because and now we will see increasingly, I think Gondi also pushing for E100. So they want to do the E100 part. And the technology already exists in terms of flex vehicles. So we already know what it takes to, take higher percentage of ethanol, what components have to change. If you go to E100, what has to change? If you're at E20, what has to change? In fact, just before the pandemic struck last year, we were in a seminar with a delegation from Brazil. And they said that they have tested it up to E27 and they don't see any significant change in performance. They said for a user, maybe acceleration is more, for somebody traction is more, for somebody mileage is more, and those are different user preferences. But he said on an overall basis, the vehicle runs normally as it runs for you. You don't even notice the change. But yes, to realize the best performance, you may have to introduce some changes.
What happens at one level, one is also that the ICE will probably be out next 10, 15 years. So EVs will take over in some sense or other. So what's your thought on this? How should one keep in mind this?
So first of all, I want to make like a disclaimer. I believe that all technologies will coexist. There is no word that I see, at least in my lifetime, which will say there'll be no ICE engines, or there'll be only electric cars, or there'll be only hydrogen. I think everything will coexist, because first of all, there is a 10-year lifespan for any vehicle, right? You're not going to just scrap it just like that. That is number one. There is a very established and very firm ecosystem around IC engines, the whole petrol, the whole fuel system, the mechanism of reaching fuel to you, the retailing points, the nearness to customers, the ease of operation, acceptance of technology, although many of those dimensions on which IC. The other thing that IC engines have done, for especially for a country like India, is that they have generated a lot of jobs in the auto component side. So just to give you a number, a comparative number, so an IC engine car will have 17,000 parts, an electric car is 700 parts. Yeah. And that fundamentally means that if you just go to electrification, what will those guys do who have jobs today? And there are almost 10 million of them. One of the big problems to solve for us is also to ensure that we have employment generation for the younger crowd, which is walking in, will continue to walk in. India is a young country. We are one of the few countries in the world that will continue to go younger for the next 10 years, right? So we have to create jobs. So I think there will be a place for electric vehicle and technologies, but there will also be a place for biofuel driven vehicles and technologies. And maybe you can foresee a day where there'll be a ethanol driven and a car which is also a hybrid. So there may be a hybrid biofuel car, which is practically the combination of both worlds and combines the good of both, does not carry the bad of either of them. So we have grown up being a hydrocarbon economies on the world, but I think time is coming where we'll become a carbohydrate economy as we move forward.
When you're expecting ethanol blending for diesel to start in India, and readiness of Praj to meet that, and insights on blending for ATF marine fuel. So when do you expect that soon?
All right. So just 2-3 clarifications as well. So ethanol to diesel blending program is not so simple, because unlike in petrol where it mixes, it does not mix readily into diesel. So you need to create a bridging element. That is the work that is going on right now, to create the bridging element while keeping it within the emission norms. So already for BS4 level, the trials are successful and done. BS6 trials are currently underway, and we will see as to how that develops over a period of time. Maybe in next one and a half year, we will know the results of that blending program. But it is definitely on, and we are very optimistic that it will technically be successful. And then, of course, it has to go through the whole rigmarole of getting into blending program and things like that, but it will happen. We don't have a doubt on that one. Coming to SAF, SAF is not ethanol blending. If I gave that impression, I'm sorry. Actually, SAF is a drop-in fuel which will replace molecule to molecule the crude oil derivative or jet aviation fuel that it gets. So ethanol is not same molecule as petrol, but SAF is exactly same molecule as jet aviation fuel today that we get from the crude oil route. So it's a drop-in fuel. You can substitute one-on-one. There's no blending required. You can decide, and today the law in the world is that you can't blend more than 50-50, 50 this and 50 that, but then there are many other reasons for that as well. So But technically speaking, it is exactly the same molecule. You can blend it. Marine fuel, as I mentioned to you, is something that we will see development out of the lignin processing that happens and how. But definitely yes, to do with the heavy sulfur fuels.
Last two questions. I think one is with the commodity prices going up, all freight rates and everything, all cost escalation happening. So how are you dealing with that? Will that have impact on your margins and profitability?
I think in immediate term, it will because if the rise is gradual, you can manage it. But if the rise is so steep as it has happened now, it will come to hit because we don't have price variation clause in our contracts with our customers. So some of our contracts will call for us to absorb this additional cost. And there is no two way about it. As we move forward, now we know the new cost, so we can build that into our new projects. But what we already have on hand in execution, maybe some customers will listen to us if we go and appeal to them, but not everyone will. So from that perspective, the commodity price rise hike and logistics hikes will have an impact on our margin. I don't know. On the other hand, our volume growth will be high enough to offset that. That's a separate issue. But per se, it will definitely have an impact.
That extent, margin expansion can be delayed.
Yeah.
Right. And one question which has come from Dr. Puneet Bansal, that technology of converting CO2 to chemicals via electrochemistry and fermentation. Any views of your views on progress of this technology?
Sorry, could you just repeat the question?
Converting CO2 to chemicals via electrochemistry and fermentation.
Yes.
Any view on that? Any progress on that?
Well, we are not working on that area yet. So, I mean, whatever I'll say will be newspaper knowledge, so that's not worth it.
Okay. I think practically I've covered most of the questions, and probably that will bring to our end to our session. So I would say thank you very much, Shishir, for joining us today and sharing your views. I think if I were to kind of summarize, Praj is a unique company. There's no doubt about that. There's no comparable. So that makes it exciting, and that also brings a lot of responsibility to that extent. So it's in a space where the future belongs, and rapidly growing. It's ably led by a great management team, which is energized, which is energizing the organization and looking to build a great organization. And I think space is there, so I guess exciting times ahead. As I would say, picture abhi baki hai, kitni baki hai, we will see.
Yes, but not to let you have the last word, I just wanted to comment on one part which I think I probably missed out. And that's the G of the ESG, the governance part. Okay. And I think we have been a strong governance company, and that is where I think one of the very important contribution gets made by the board that has seen this company through different phases, right? So while there are new inductees on our board, we also have members who have seen this company through different phases of its journey. And this combination is what is actually going to help us to stay strong. Our founders are, for them, this is passion and life and everything else later on. But first, these two things, our board is like this. So I think technology will be having a play. People can get technology, but I think one of the strong pillars for ensuring sustainability is great governance. And I think that is where we are very, very thankful to the whole governance structure that we have, the resilience that we've built in, which will help us to actually address these issues in a very, very strong way. So that even when a load of opportunity comes, we won't be blown away and we'll be able to take care of it.
Absolutely. And I have seen, I think, how governance has played. And I have seen firsthand over the last 10 years, even in difficult times, I think that is where the companies get tested. I think governance has been, AAA. And I think, so in that sense, you also score, which all the market people these days do care about, ESG score. So right. I think you are way up. So your all scores, you are bursting off the chart. So again, like I will end with the Carnelian, internal Carnelian saying that, if there's a tailwind, and you are on the right ship, you can really go far. So yes. We hope that we go really big far. You go very far, and we also along with you ride that journey. So with thank you very much.
Thank you for an engaging session. Thank you so much, and thank you for all the people who asked the questions as well.
Thank you everyone for joining us. Do remain engaged. We shall keep coming back with these ideas. And if you have any suggestions please do reach out to us. We look forward to remain engaged with you and keep sharing our thoughts with you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.